just going to get started now. So today's webinar should no longer be a duration of an hour, and there will be a recording distributed after this webinar. So we will send an email link providing where you can watch it and also a survey of questions about today's webinar. So today's content is going to explore the definition behind AT and what this means and the various demographics and groups that it applies to, the reforms that are currently taking place in Code of Victoria and SRVs, affiliates with the coordination of the ATFA campaign and what's our involvement with that and shaping the policies going ahead. And again, like I mentioned, we are also very honoured and very pleased to present our two guest speakers for today's webinar. So we've got Michael Davin. So he's the Chair of Accounting and Business Information Systems at the University of Melbourne. We've also got Ruth Hosking up in Bendigo. And she's an all-around advocate, volunteer, and a lived experience carer of AT for her husband, Bill. And she'll go into a bit more depth about that when she speaks today. And with today's webinar, it will conclude with a Q&A before we shortly wrap up. So again, like I briefly mentioned, if you do have any questions, feel free to put them in the chat bar or keep them in your head and then ask them towards the end. Again, we may not be able to answer all questions, just depending on the length of time that we do have, but hopefully we'll be able to get to majority of them. So I'm just going to give an acknowledgement to country very quickly. So we acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land, the Bunurong people of the Kulin Nations. We acknowledge all First Nations people, the land on which we work and do business. We pay our respects to their continuing culture and all elders, past, present, and emerging, who have taught their children, adults, and communities for over 65,000 years on these great lands, the oldest living culture in the world. We commit ourselves to the ongoing journey of reconciliation. We acknowledge the legacy and care of our environment by the traditional owners of the land and the responsibility we have to continue this care. So I just wanted to give a brief introduction about our organisation. So Council on the Aging, Code of Victoria. See if we'll be okay to pop up the slides. Oh, yep, all good. Okay, so our Council on the Aging Victoria is a leading non-for-profit organisation representing the interests and rights of people aged over 50 in Victoria. For over 70 years, we have led government, corporate and community thinking about the positive aspects of ageing in Victoria, the state. Today, our focus is on promoting opportunities for and protecting the legal rights of people over the age of 50, and we value aging and embrace its opportunities for personal growth, contribution, and self-expression. This belief drives benefit to the nation and states alongside our communities, families, and individuals. And we also have Senior Rights Victoria. So SRV is a program of Code of Victoria and the key statewide service dedicated to advancing the rights of older people and the early intervention into or prevention of elder abuse in our community. SRV has a team of experienced advocates, lawyers and social workers who provide free information, advice, referral, legal advice, legal casework and support to other people who are either at risk or are experiencing elder abuse. SRV supports and empowers older people through provision of legal advice directly to the older person. So with all of that said, we're going to hop into today's webinar content, and that is, what is AT? So as you can see on the screen, we have two definitions of what AT encompasses. So from the Assistive Technology for All ATFA campaign, we have assistive technology is an umbrella term that is used to describe any aid, piece of equipment or home modification that helps someone overcome the impact of disability. We've also got the NDIS, so the National Disability Insurance Scheme here in Australia, that says AT, assistive technology, enables people with disability to live a better, more independent and more inclusive life. It enables people with disability to maximise their abilities at home, in the community and in the workplace, ensuring greater economic and social participation. Both definitions hold the same core factor, which is entirely creating better access, aid and support for the individual that requires the AT. With that, AT is also a very malleable concept. It's always changing. It encompasses various different equipments and different service deliveries for all of these people who are affected and need access to AT. It can be simple, these AT products or these services. They can be simple, complex. They can be a low-cost item, or sometimes they can actually be very expensive just because of the customization for an individual. And this may or may not be cost deducted, and this may or may not be partially funded. And because of this, it can lead large out-of-pocket gaps, which many of you as providers may be aware of regarding your recipients. And AET, as many of you may be aware, it actually isn't a choice. It's a requirement for an individual to be able to remain independent, maintain their social skills, and help with their physical health. It's not a choice that they have, it's a necessity in life, hence why the importance behind AET. And so in the next slide, we've included a short video from the ATFA Assistive Technology for All, and this just gives a better, more brief understanding behind the definition.
Anyone can acquire a disability at any time. Many people with disability need assistive technology to help them live, work, and play. The NDIS can fully fund assistive technology for people with disability, but many people are missing out. The NDIS only funds support for 10% of Australians with disability. In fact, anyone is excluded if they acquire a disability after they turn 65 or were already 65 when the NDIS became available. Those who are excluded from the NDIS face huge costs, wait months or years for limited funding, rely on family members for support, or miss out altogether. The Assistive Technology for All campaign wants the government to fund a national program so every Australian can access assistive technology, because no Australian should be missing out. To find out more or support the campaign, go to assistivetechforall.org.au or call 03 9655 2140.
Beautiful. So I hope that video just did a little bit more of an introduction regarding behind what is AET. And with that, we've provided some examples of what AET is, so the assistive technology, how it can come in various different forms. Thank you, Barbara. So for example, some AET equipment can include, but it isn't limited to, as we've got ramp or rails to enable someone to enter and exit their home without support, or in-home modifications for assistance in bathrooms. We've also got a device to help someone turn the pages of a book. And a walking frame to assist with balance and mobility, which may be a low cost, but create a large advantage for someone of using AET. A cane to assist someone who is blind to move around safely and independently within their own home and outside their home. We have a wheelchair to promote mobility and independence. Voice dictation software to enable someone with limited dexterity to use a computer. A prosthetic limb to enhance balance, mobility, and functionality, even a splint to overcome muscle strength and muscle loss and enable someone to walk safely and independently on their own or with aid, an electronic communication device to someone who isn't able to voice or raise their communicable concerns, and customized power chairs and vehicle adaptations, which is often very much a high cost item. So as you can see, just even through the mention of many of these brief items, they are a range of complexity and they range from very simple to expensive items. So it's very much dependent on the individual and their needs and their wants and desires that need to be taken into consideration. So that leads into the inclusion of augmentative and alternative communication products and devices, which are also essential in providing aid and living with complex communication needs. So that builds upon that. So this leads us to the major reason behind this webinar. So what makes AET so important? What makes it this important that we need to host a webinar? Well, let's look at what the World Health Organization, also known as WHO, says. And they say that the primary purpose of AET products is to maintain or improve an individual's function and independence. Therefore, thereby promoting their well-being, AET enables people to live healthy, productive, independent, and dignified lives, and to participate in education, the labour market, and civic life. Basically, AET is of significant importance for many people with disability, and it provides them with a better, equitable access to life. So AET devices themselves, the wraparound services and supports that people are reliant on, These are all essential factors for providing care for people who are weighed down by disability, who rely on these AT devices to have some assistance in managing their condition or even just participating in their passions or being involved in social or family or friends aspects. So it's a large scale that can have a large impact on their availability and their ability to participate in their life. So this also leads into the response of, well, what can I do as a provider to support my clients who need to access AT services? So we asked, how can CHIS providers support clients to access AT? We've just provided a few of these ones. So providers need to align with CHIS objectives as outlined in the 2022 to 2024 program manual to provide adequate support in accessing AT. So this can include, number one, provide quality support to older people to provide equitable, flexible, and timely services in accessing AT. So we've actually had a lot of consultations with older people accessing services, and we have found that either A, they aren't even aware of these services because of the communication, and B, they aren't able to access provider services because a lot of them are actually online or they are unable to be walked through the process. So a lot of consultations have actually talked about how recipients of AT don't even know that they're able to access, say, a new smartwatch that detects falls. And a lot of them are thinking that this is a high cost that can't be subsidised, but a lot of them can, depending on which scheme you go through. So it's more about awareness and seeing what the customer or the recipient can also benefit from it. And number two, we've had provide direct service delivery to CHISP clients and support carers in providing adequate care to clients who cannot access AT. So again, we've found that carers are often being left out of the loop or their knowledge of the recipient who may not be who can actually benefit from the carer's advice. So their suggestion of AT, their products and referrals, remember they're with the client a lot of the time, helping them assist. They see what goes behind the doors, what they actually will more likely use, what they may need but prefer not to use as an AT because it may cause discomfort or it may cause embarrassment. So we need to be more aware and continually implementing not only what the client themselves wants and needs, but also what the care advises. And number three, so we have ensuring clients have equal access to AT services and products that appropriately meet their social and cultural needs. So we've heard directly from consumers that some recipients who access AT products, they actually don't use them. They actually go left alone in a corner because of their embarrassment or inability to be able to use it because they're too afraid to ask their providers for additional help. So sometimes just taking the extra step to run through with recipients about what their AT needs are or how to use it, it's like sometimes think, well, I know personally for myself, sometimes I go to the gym and I go, I can't use that equipment. I don't know how to use it. And I'm pretty sure a few people have been there, but sometimes you just have to go up and ask, or sometimes it would be nice to have the person come up to you and say, hey, you may not know how to use this. You may do know how to use it, but either way, I'm happy to run through it with you. It's kind of like going along that same lines. So moving on to number four, provide access to AT that facilitates and promotes independence and a positive well-being. So if they have a passion, if they have a need and a want and a desire within a special particular area, we need to think about, well, what is this AT need? How can it be customized? How does it need to be designed? We need to ask the consumer, what do you like about this activity or this hobby that you would like to do? How can it be better supported to you through your AT needs? What AT have you liked in the past? What AT haven't you liked or have liked? Or has this interfered in any other realm of social aspect or physical aspect? It's more so, again, coming back to that idea of listening to the consumer. Again, they are the recipient of the AT device. They are the ones using it. They are the ones who rely on it. And it's more so going with them and working with them to see, how can I better help them? How can I better help impact them that they use this AT device? And it's not just sitting in the corner being wasted. It's helping them better life to a more equitable life. And this goes to number five. So knowledge regarding the latest updated AT products, services, and education webinars to provide accurate and relevant information to clients. So again, we've heard through our consultations with other relevant peak organisations that providers need to be aware of the importance of email reminders and just newsletters. And there are organisations such as OPAR or Errata that offer sector-specific webinars designed especially for providers. And it's the numerous programs that consumers can be offered outside of their eligibility and processes for other avenues that sometimes providers aren't aware of. Sometimes providers don't know about this upcoming grant, or they haven't been aware of a different scheme that's been introduced that may be better suited to their recipient of AT. So it's more just keeping up to date and development with that, and making sure that everyone is constantly aware of the changing environment within the sector, because we all work in this sector and we know that it's constantly changing, it's constantly developing, it's constantly evolving. So it's important to just make sure that we're continuing to keep up to date, not only for ourselves and for our organisations and community progress, but more so just for the recipients and consumers that are reliant on us to provide this information that is essential for their living. And so this also goes down into number six, open collaboration amongst the COP, so community of practice, as many of you will probably be aware of. So providers to ask suggestions for other CHESS providers or refer clients to more relevant services or product knowledge providers. So all I can say really is that the more you contribute, the more you learn, the more you help others. This is as soon as I came into this sector, I was amazed about how many people were willing to share their knowledge. And I think that's something that I love about my job and I love about this sector that we work in. It's that we are all willing to share one another our successes and our failures too, and what we've known. And the thing is, sometimes we only share it with the small people that we can connect with. Well, the COP, the community of practice, is a great area to provide not only just connections, but what we've learned, what we've failed, what we have learned from other people. And all I can just say is to just try and keep involvement in that. And so the seventh tip actually has its own page, which is just keep up to date. So as you know, CHESS is not designed to replace existing state-managed schemes to provide medical aid and equipment. So medical aids of subsidy schemes, for example. So CHESS service providers are encouraged to access these state and territory aids and equipment and personal loan programs. So where they are appropriate, of course, for your consumer. Where a local CHESS GEET provider is unable to meet a client's needs, referrals can be made to national GEET providers or the GEET to go. So the following table below outlined basically the main individual state schemes that are eligible for older age Australians. And these schemes include access to AT with some programs focused on specialised products. And the external schemes eligible for older Australians, that can also include the custom AT for other people, a focus on sensory or progressive neurological diseases, artificial limb schemes, orthopaedics and processes, injury insurance or work insurance even. And various schemes that support eligible older Australians are very much excellent, but many schemes make it difficult for clients to navigate which program is best suited to their needs. So providers also just need to be aware of these programs and the accessibility of these programs for the clients. And so this comes into, again, keeping up to date and reaching out to that COP, reaching out to other people, seeing if they know, hey, my consumer or this recipient needs this. Has anyone got any awareness? And it's more so that promoting of talk and promoting of not being afraid to say, hey, I need help. And this is best for my recipient. There is no embarrassment behind that. It's more so being able to reach out, stand with confidence and independence and say, hey, I need this help. I need to be able to reach out and gather more information. And so that jumps into slide 11. So how do clients want to be supported to access AT? So number one, additional follow-up support, maintenance and repairs. So this should be implemented alongside more frequent reassessments, easier access to AT equipment trials, reviews, ensuring the appropriate use of long-term usability of AT products. And number two, clients would like to feel empowered and independent. This can be emphasized through providers providing just even more frequent client participation and involvement in decision making. And again, that goes back to what we were saying about providers looking into what people actually need and what they find essential in providing the best happiness in their day-to-day life. And these processes and taking into consideration their personal liking or their even dislike towards AT products will just help not only the consumer, but also the provider also help others, not only their other recipients, but also other providers in saying, I have found that this XYZ has been useful for this. And it's more so that open communication again. And number three, reduced need for hospital admissions, earlier steps of implementation. So again, we need to be able to provide those different sorts of early implementation to remove the hospital admissions, remove that, remove the pressure on the healthcare system and on the sector. The more that we are able to help reduce the earlier need for hospital admissions, the better we are for just helping our consumers in a whole. And number four, clients want to receive the most use of their AT products. Providers can assist in elaborating on what the aid and support that they can provide through encouragement and the ensuring the appropriate use of the AT. But again, this comes to going through how this can best help them and asking them, how does this help you? That's more so the clarification behind that. And number five, clients want reduced wait times to access AT. So providers keeping up to date with clients and the stages of their access to AT will help reassure clients of their progress forward. And number six, alternative methods of communication between providers and clients. So online face-to-face discussions, sometimes face-to-face may be preferred, especially for the older population. We've had a lot of consultations saying that people don't like to reschedule their meetings with their providers because they're too afraid to try and access online or be afraid that they won't be able to see their provider face-to-face, so that they'd rather not attend. But again, we need to help reassure clients going forward that we are able to communicate to their needs, communicate with what they find is best for them. Number seven, providers apply relevant and appropriate knowledge regarding grants and funding extensions, such as the GEET program. So in February last year, there was an introduction for a new framework approach for the aged care. So as you know, there's been going on a lot more reforms. So followed by an introduction of the NDIS to undergo a series of reboots back in March last year, which is recently highlighted again in the media since last August, the QI program also expanded from April 1st, 2023. So February this year, the Australian government began working on providing greater access to AT through the new reformed in-home aged care, so the AT-HM scheme. And this new scheme has been discussed in the recent paper, The Assistive Technologies and Home Modification Scheme, ATHM, for in-home aged care discussion paper. And that was written by the Australian Government of Health and Aged Care. And the scheme aids to provide greater access to AT, alongside a greater avenue in allowing providers to support their clients and also create a more equitable, accountable and transparent manner. And this will likely come into effect in 2024, as we are aware, and alongside the new in-home aged care program. And certain changes are being considered for the new scheme. So this can include webinars more often. This can include workshops and communication platforms, which all is just working towards greater transparency for clients from CHIS providers, which is essential to what we need, and more for promoting towards a better assistive help towards this sector. So the changes to the scheme would provide access to appropriate wraparound services, independence programs, and follow-up assessments with many more supports. So with that said, I would like to hop to our guest speaker, Michael Davin. So we are very pleased to have our Michael here today and share his knowledge with us about his work in the AT field. So Michael, again, like I mentioned, is the Chair of Accounting and Business Information Systems at the University of Melbourne. He has led industry-engaged research projects in business intelligence, financial reporting, data governance, and analytics amongst various alternative areas over the past 30 years. So as you can tell, Michael's a very busy man and also very knowledgeable in this field. So Michael is co-author of the 2022 Assistive Technology AT for All, exploring the benefits and challenges of timely access to AT when ineligible for the NDIS, and this is his report, which he will be explaining about. The report investigated the impact that challenges have in accessing AT for individuals who are ineligible for the NDIS funding. Michael explores the positive attributes that come from access to AT, accompanied by the negative impacts that burden people's accessibility towards the need for AT. So, Michael, when you are ready, feel free to share your wealth of knowledge.
Thanks, Rachel. I don't know about wealth of knowledge, but I'm happy to share what we've been discovering and what we've been doing. You may be wondering what's an accounting academic looking at AT and disability. I actually have two adult children with a disability, one on the NDIS, one not on the NDIS. I've served on the board of a number of disability support providers. So I do a lot of work in the disability space as a context for looking at some of the things that I'm interested in. And I also have an honorary appointment over in our engineering school, which gives me a bit of a tech spin on things as well. If we can bring the slide deck up for the presentation that I've got, I'll happily talk you through what we did. This was a project that was funded by the Melbourne Disability Institute. We run a community-based research scheme there, and CODA applied for that. And basically, that means that we farm out some academics, and this is a project I picked up to come and have a look at trying to address some problems and concerns that are coming from the community. And so in this project, the key question that we were really looking at was how and why should AT be made available to those in need? So we go to the next slide. What are the social and economic benefits of providing timely access to AT? What factors limit individuals from gaining timely access to AT? And for the purpose of this, we took a very broad definition of what an AT is. That's consistent with the definitions that Rachel introduced earlier, but we want to make sure we're being inclusive in seeing where we go. And so with CODA's assistance, we sent the survey out to try and get responses about how people were dealing with AT, whether they were waiting for AT, whether they had funding, whether they were applying for funding, what stages they were, the nature of the supports that they had, and so forth. And I'm used to giving presentations where I get lots of questions in an academic environment. So one of the practices I have there is start with the findings and then elaborate, because sometimes you don't get past that slide. And so some of the key findings that I'll also conclude with: timeliness of access is not about differences in need. That was one of the interesting things when we looked at those who had AT versus those who were waiting for AT. It wasn't about differences in the need, because we asked them to describe what their needs were and the nature of the challenges they were facing. It really comes down to two key factors: lack of available funding and the lead times in acquiring the AT, because those lead times can sometimes be quite long, in part as you're waiting for the funding to get approval, and in part sometimes in acquiring the AT because it might require some customization or isn't an easily obtainable off-the-shelf item. The other thing that I think is really important to highlight here is that AT reduces demands for other funded supports and reliance on informal supports. So putting my business hat on, this is a smart economic investment to buy AT, because not only do we get the social well-being benefits, we get an economic benefit because we're not having to expend so much on the other funded supports, the funded carers, the support workers and resources that are used there. So it's an effective allocation of resources to do this. So I love it when we find things that are great for the people and also work out it to be economically smart, because it's a much easier justification, because we want to be able to achieve those social and well-being goals. And of course, the resources, the economic resources, are always a bit of a challenge there, but it's nice to see that. So let's delve into some of the details of what we saw some of the impacts were. And on the next slide, we're going to have a look at the impact on everyday living. And everything that I'm presenting here is extracted from that report. I've collated it in slightly different ways, but if you get that report, which CODA has got available, it's also available on the Melbourne Disability Institute website, has all this detail. So we looked at how much it was changing several aspects of their everyday living. And the key things that I want to draw out this time are independent living, everyday services, engagement in recreation, and transport services. And we asked them on a scale of 1 to 5, how much would this be impacting your opportunity to access and engage in more independent living, get out in the community, transport services, those sorts of things. And overall, you can see there's massive impacts. And we broke this down for those who had acquired AT versus those who hadn't, so you sort of see what the expectation was in the not yet acquired and what the realization was. And so we see here in independent living, those who have acquired AT actually seeing more engagement in independent living than what those were expecting to be able to occur if they hadn't yet acquired the AT. And even taking advantage of things like transport services, again, improved once you've actually got the AT. And so I think part of the story that we can see here, and what I'm giving you here are the percentages of the great or extreme impact. So 4 or 5 on that 5-point scale, which is quite a sizable impact. And you've always got to look at the lived experience. And so you'll see in the report and in some of the slides here that we have some quotes. And I love this one. What did we get out of AT? I got improved quality of life, decreased risk of hospitalization. I got to stay living at home and I didn't need to move into a nursing home from a 76-year-old man. And you think about all those sort of things, it's like, why aren't we providing the ATs? This is clearly something that is beneficial. What about quality of life? So on our next slide, let's have a look at how AT is impacting quality of life. And if we have a look at issues around mental health and well-being, community engagement, social engagement, and family relationships. We did look at a few other things, but I'm just giving you a snapshot here. And again, we're looking at where we're seeing great or extreme improvement here. And overall, we're seeing most of our survey responses are really pushing very strongly that they're expecting or have received the improvements in mental health, community engagement, social engagement, and family relationships. Now, it's a little bit less glowing when you split it up between the not yet acquired and the acquired stage of things, but I do want to highlight something here that you've got to be careful in how you interpret some of this data. The not yet acquired seem to have higher expectations that are going to improve quality of life than those that have realized. And I think there are a couple of factors to bear in mind here. Some of those are the things that Rachel was talking about how carers and support workers need to help individuals to make the most use of those AT devices that they get and support them in taking advantage of those and deal with the anxiety and the embarrassment that sometimes comes along with those AT. But there's also a fundamental issue here that those who have acquired AT are further along in the process, which will also mean that they're more likely to be in terms of health and impacts of that disability and aging is going to be much more severe. So by the time you get the AT, you're probably in a worse position in terms of community engagement, social engagement, family relationships and mental health and wellbeing already. So I think that's important to bear in mind. So the fact that we're not seeing the quality of life impacts as much as what was expected, I think there's a lot of alternative explanations than just people think AT is going to be a bigger and better solution than what it is. And again, let's look at the lived experience here. One participant commented, having a voice again is everything. I feel I can be included more in social interactions. I've started going out again and I feel like I have more control and choice. And I love that they use the word control and choice. That's a nice ping off some NDIS language there to sort of say, that's what we want to be able to do. That's what quality of life is really about. And that's what we should be enabling with the technologies and the way we're investing and supporting that sector of the community. So, I'd be remiss as an accountant if we didn't get into thinking about some of what the broader economic benefits are of what's going on here, because we don't have unlimited resources. And having been on the board of a large disability support provider and having to decide resource allocation decisions and that trade-off between how do we make sure we're financially sustainable while still meeting all those social goals can be really challenging. What I want to highlight here is, again, some really interesting things of how getting that AT doesn't just have those social and well-being benefits. We're looking here at greater extreme improvement in how much they're having to draw on other supports or assistance. So need for carers or support workers, greatly or extremely improvements. They're not having to rely on carers or support workers as much when they get the AT. The expenditure on carers and support workers is not as great with AT. And the need for professional medical assistance, again, is something that is reduced with the acquisition of the AT. And as Rachel's highlighted, given the environment where we're in, where healthcare resources are already stretched, being able to address that, I think, is really valuable for it. And just a reminder, it looks like it's not as good a picture once they've acquired the AT. I think that's some of that time lag again, and how the needs have increased over time for that individual. So by the time they get the AT, they're going to need more support anyhow. They're going to be spending more, and they're going to need more professional medical assistance. So even seeing the reduction after that. So why the wait? If we go to the next slide, we'll see the weight obviously is all about funding. And what we saw in our responses was an average wait time after applying for funds was 16 and a half months before they saw the AT come through. And in some cases, we saw up to 68 months. And I really feel, when you read the quotes from people about how their experience, their life experience here, is a myriad of delays and bureaucracies. And this one, particularly for providers, is the thing that since the NDIS came, providers will not assist anymore unless you have the NDIS. So I'm very conscious of that being an issue. And we need to make sure that just because someone's NDIS or not NDIS funded shouldn't be a deciding factor on what sort of supports they get, because I'm firsthand aware of how messy the bureaucracy of the NDIS is. What I thought was interesting here was when we looked at the funding mix was relatively little from government. Non-government funding was a big part of it, and self-funding was a major driver in the audience that we were looking at here, who are not supported by the NDIS. And it's not, as I've said at the start, about need. It's really need agnostic when it comes to that. And the need is a need. It's not a want, it is a need. As one participant put it, whether I receive funding, I needed that AT to be able to walk. There was no other option. And so those sorts of things need to be borne in mind, that this is not something that will make, oh, it'll be nice to have. This is things that is going to dramatically change the quality of life of that individual. They need it for that quality of life. And it makes economic sense to do that, given that there are other benefits that we see in cost reductions elsewhere. So in conclusion, in my last slide, just go back to those key points again. It's not about differences in need. It's a lack of funding and the lead times. And we need to do something about the lead times bureaucratically. And we need to think about how we are getting that funding. And AT for All is a very good initiative in that regard. And recognise that it's reducing demands on those other supports. So improving access to AT is going to provide economic as well as social benefits. And hopefully we'll see that improve in the future and governments will start to listen. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Michael. Again, thank you for just sharing your, I think it's a wealth of information, to be honest. But thank you so much for sharing that, especially the last part of your slide where it was a need. This gentleman said a need. Regardless of funding, it's a need. Yeah. Especially the impact that you've mentioned of support workers and carers that we've mentioned earlier. I think finding that as a part of your research has just cemented, especially what we've said at the start. So thank you so much. Again, Michael's slides will also be provided. So thank you for that, Michael. But next we have Ruth Hosking. So our next guest speaker, Ruth, who I have had the pleasure of chatting with Ruth and getting to know more with her previously. So hearing of her experience with AT, her background and advocating, my gosh, Ruth, I think can definitely say that she has have had many achievements, and she's been a part of many movements, many advocations, and to be honest, this woman is inspiring. So I'm very glad that we have had her be able to join the webinar today. So Ruth, her background, she has volunteered at the Uniting Age Well since the mid-1980s and is a recipient of the Medal of the Order of Australia for her services to the community. So Ruth, when you do have a chance, please speak away. We're glad to hear your wealth of knowledge now.
Thank you, Rachel, and good morning to everyone. I am my husband Bill's carer. Bill had his 99th birthday on Anzac Day, which he was able to attend because he has on loan a wheelchair and a friend pushed him. This morning he's at Probus, where the members are looking after him because they know I'm doing this presentation, and he has a walking frame there, and his hearing aid, and the member who organises the seating has put in a comfortable armchair in which to sit for the meeting, which is much appreciated. And Bill's also a returned serviceman, and I met him in my first year nurse training, as he had had broke his leg, back injuries, and used crutches for 6 months. And we're now coping with disability. I'm now a retired community aged nurse and community general nurse, and of course is being made in the assisted technology industry. And my husband uses at least 22 different of equipment. During World War II, Bill was on ground duties in the Air Force. They never wore him, resulting in him needing hearing aids at a very young age. In this period, many changes of size and helpfulness have occurred. The current ones he has have an external volume aid which hangs around. The printing on this black aid, re, off, on, etc., is such that it is very hard for him to see. Providers of this aid or tool include the manufacturer of it, the wholesaler, and the provider has been advised, but as yet nothing has changed. Bill's walking stick because 40 years ago he required spinal fusion surgery, no doubt because of the tractor accident. The outcome of that was very successful and change needed for permanent, because if he hadn't had the surgery, he would have had use of a wheelchair. 17 years back, I needed surgery. My discharge plan for post-surgical support scheme referral. The hospital's discharge planner sent my request to our local community support service, whose assessor visited me the day after my return. I was known to their service. We had cooperated in my community nursing days. The council officer transferred my request to the Department of Veteran Affairs, whose assessor immediately put in additional home help 1.5 hours a fortnight. In this time, we have had 6 different services and many changes in their staff. One service provider went into liquidation, 3 p.m. really caused chaos for those requiring personal care, showering, etc. Our not-for-profit service provider is based in New South Wales, a rural city. Bendigo is in Victoria. Their communication with me is excellent, and I'm very satisfied. And their current staff member comes now weekly, is wonderful. Because of my husband's painful unstable, because his fractured leg was his left one, so of course his right leg was carried him around. His mobility continues to deteriorate. 17 years on, we still have our title domestic assistants, but to me, another type of assisted technology. Fair's Home Service Coordinator reviews his well-being every 6 months. Part of the original DBS included an occupational therapist's home visit, and that visit resulted in handrails in the shower boom for me too. Last year, our handrails were installed at the toilet door, a ramp at the back door frame, as walking frame tyres and brakes wear out quite quickly when it's used. About 12 years back, I was started using his walking frame when out and about. And now he regularly receives physiotherapy management in our home, which is very much appreciated. For birthday presents, I have given Bill inside the house walking frame. It took quite a while before he would use the first indoor walking frame. The current model of walking includes the tray, but is a little narrower and so easier to maneuver in our house, which wasn't designed for residents who have mobility issues. Bill's assistive equipment technology list also includes a very expensive lounge chair, which he bought privately, and we've never regretted that. An electric bed, bed poles and wheelchair are all on DVA loan. DVA installed a raised toilet seat, provided drinking cup with two adjustable handles, lightweight foam-handled cutlery, helpful because Bill has weak and at times painful hands, arthritis due to arthritis and a finger accident. The special cutlery enables manageable grip and saves me cutting up meat if it's chops or steak, and reminds him to be independent at meals. But he uses normal cutlery when he's out, as he will be today for dinner. I have purchased adult bibs, which were well received by Bill. He didn't, though, for some time use the shower stool, which I also bought. I wanted that. Video phone, another item is the video phone provided under a Telstra research scheme, as we were one of 4,000 Australian deaf clients who protested to the federal government when contract for provision of the phone being used by the deaf was withdrawn. This video phone does not require Bill to use a handpiece, provides social conversation as Bill cannot hear on a mobile or landline phone. He has a Medi Alert system in place, wears shoes with Velcro instead of laces, uses protected underwear as he has prostate cancer, a knee brace on his right knee, shoehorn, pickup stick, has two walking sticks with quad stoppers instead of the traditional round attachment on the ends. A tip to consumers, prices for all types of equipment vary, so shop around or online if these options are for you. In summary, to make the most of available assistive technology and range of equipment now on the market, They're available mainly in chemist shops and care shops. The older person or the client, their family or carers need to acknowledge the client's decline. The contributing causes to the decline, the client's medical history, for example, whether the history contains evidence of an accident or the client has an acute or medical issue, leading to particularly reduced lower limb function, which in turn affects your mobility. Another example that I've found through my contact with many Bendigo residents, reduced shoulder, arm, hand function may lead to difficulty lifting saucepans, etc. So a meal delivery service is indicated, and we have that too. How to use assistive technology. Know where in your locality to seek appropriate provider assistance. The possibility of being eligible for government subsidised equipment, which requires a My Aged Care assessment. The first step in identifying whether or not the client is eligible for subsidised equipment, otherwise you buy. Remember, the introduction of the NDIS has increased the number of equipment providers, including Go Online service. Carers, be patient, as the client may not readily accept, because of their pride, that using a walking stick, as may be looked on, that the client is old, and we are. I used one, and when I advised my GP, her reply, what a sensible action, as you are reducing possibility of a fall. And when I go for my afternoon walk, I used one of Bill's walking frames. Sometimes while the carer might recognise the need for a particular piece of equipment and know of its availability, getting the client to use it takes time. Also, if an OT assessment is necessary, that takes time and is costly if you are paying for it from your home care package or privately. I can assure you that once client accepts and uses the equipment, their quality of life, well-being lifts, and he is better able to participate in social activities like RSL and Probus. What I believe providers need to consider: no one piece of equipment suits every situation or circumstances, as there are many variables in the type of equipment. For example, wheelchair size for the client to consider. Any printing or equipment should be easily able to be read, as reasonable that the older client has reduced eyesight. Also realise there are a range of provider categories. Each piece of equipment requires involvement from designers, manufacturers, wholesale, retail distributors before the service provider can recommend the equipment or the client buys it. Thank you for inviting me, Rachel.
Thank you so much, Ruth, again, for your wealth of knowledge too. And it was such a privilege to hear about you and your husband, Bill. It was just greatly impactful. I think it's great to hear, especially from a direct source, about how the impact of AT can have on not only just the individual, but also the lover or the family or the carer or friends. And with that, I just want to quickly hop into a wrap-up before we go into a quick questions and answers. So I just want to do a quick note again that we will be distributing a short survey about today's webinar via email, so you'll be able to access that when you leave. And we would also really appreciate your responses, just so we can continue to improve and develop the most relevant information for providers and other people. And also, I'm very excited to announce that Code of Victoria is also hosting another two webinars. So And these are designed again for TRIS providers on the inclusive use of digital and non-digital communications. So these sessions will be held on June 16th and June 8th. Oh, sorry, June 6th and June 8th. And so for any information, please feel free to visit CRODA Victoria. We'll also send out that email with about the dates, including in the survey questions and whatnot. Or if you do have any questions, feel free to reach out to me. So it will also be my colleague, Martin, hosting that. And Martin is a lovely man full of wealth of information too. So he'll be able to provide that. Thank you, Steve. So again, I'd highly recommend that these two webinars to check them out and share it if you like it. But I would like to quickly hop into any questions or answers, especially whilst we have Ruth and Michael here, because again, they are a wealth of knowledge. So if anybody has any questions, feel free to put them in the chat box. And I might have Steve help me point out if there are any big questions. So, oh yeah, from Julie C, where can I get help to acquire APs? I'm ineligible for the NDIS, but I have trouble walking more than 5 meters. Okay. Okay, Julie, I actually might be able to get in contact with you, so I might try to individually contact you regarding that. All good. All good. Any other questions or comments or concerns? Oh, thank you. No? All good. All right. Perfect. Thank you again, everyone, for attending. And thank you again, Michael. And thank you again, Ruth. If there are any questions, again, we are sending out a survey. So if there are any dying questions, I will try and reach out to Michael or Ruth and get them to answer your comments or questions. But again, thank you for attending today's AP webinar. We are very privileged to have Michael and Ruth here today and also to be able to share everything with you. So again, that concludes today's webinar and the recording will be posted at a later date. All right, so see everyone at a later time. Thank you again. Bye.